Thursday, September the 14th, is Holy Cross Day. It's something that the Anglicans honor and remember, and most Catholic parishes do as well. And since we are meeting today instead of Thursday, I thought we'd do it today anyway. It is, it'll be obvious what it is as we go along, as we think about the cross and what it meant for us and to Jesus as well. So that's what we're going to use for our theme today. So all the pictures are various types of crosses. Here I invite you to say it with me. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Reading today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 to 24-25. For the message about Christ's death on the cross is nonsense to those who are being lost, but for us who are being saved, it is God's power. The scripture says, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and set aside the understanding of the scholars. So then, where does that leave the wise, or the scholars, or the skillful debaters of this world? God has shown that this world's wisdom is foolishness. For God in his wisdom made it impossible for people to know him by means of their own wisdom. Instead, by means of the so-called foolish message we preach, God decided to save those who believe. Jews want miracles for proof, and Greeks look for logic. As for us, we proclaim the crucified Christ, a message that is offensive to the Jews and nonsense to the Gentiles. But for those whom God has called, both Jews and Gentiles, this message is Christ, who is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For what seems to be God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and what seems to be God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord. Boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Galatians 6:14. The cross is a big deal in our faith. It was a symbol from the very beginning. Even the crazy movies use it to scare away vampires. Now, the Roman Catholics prefer the crucifix, which still has Jesus on the cross, and that's showing us how much Jesus was as coming as human being for us. Many others prefer the empty cross, meaning the resurrection. Different messages, but both important messages. I can remember many, many decades ago, I got my first cross necklace, and I like wearing them, and I've got a whole bunch of them now. There are many things that the cross can elicit in us, but the cross is the cross because of what Jesus did. And Holy Cross Day is to remind us that we are forgiven by Christ's sacrifice, that by the cross, the payment for sin has been paid. And Jesus says to us, if any of you would follow me, take up your cross daily and follow me. That's from Luke. So what is the cross? The cross is where Jesus died completely. But what is outstanding about that is that Jesus did not benefit from the death or the cross. It was all for us. And if we would follow Christ, taking up the cross, we would abandon our personal opinions and our personal goals and our personal ideals for what God wants of us. We were watching a movie this week. I don't remember what the movie was, but I remember we watched it. And they were talking about success. And it dawned on me as the movie, as that came on, that success to people who live for the world is very different from success for those who live for the cross. Because success living for the cross could mean losing absolutely everything. And that could then be useful in God's eternal plan. Where in the world, if you lose everything, they think, oh, you've lost everything. But maybe in Christ, we have gained everything. It's what Paul said. He counts everything as garbage, although the Greek word is actually manure, human manure. When we were in Africa, the people there told us what it is in Swahili, and it's a word that I won't use in a chapel service. That's how Paul regarded all the successes of the world. And he had great success. And then he met Jesus, and all of it was just like manure in comparison to what he found in the cross. In the cross, he found an eternal purpose. In the cross, he recognized what God does for us. In the cross, Paul recognized that the life he lived here, was not for himself. It was for others. So the cross takes us from our human thinking and the social expectations, turns it upside down and inside out, and says, no, we don't live for ourselves. We live for others. And in some ways, for Christians, you watch them and it comes fairly easily. You notice Christians often will do kind things without even thinking. We'll give a word of encouragement as though it was a second nature. Christians will pray for other people, because they care enough. So in the cross, we lose ourselves and find Christ. And Paul says, may I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, in what Christ gave us so that we could lose ourselves and everything we are and be everything in Christ. In Galatians 2:20, Paul wrote, I am crucified with Christ. That means dead, by the way. It doesn't mean slumber. It just means dead. I am crucified with Christ. I am dead. Nevertheless, I live by the grace of the Son of God who gave himself for me. The The life that I now live, I live by the life that Jesus gave me. Not only is that a tremendous challenge, obviously, but I find it tremendously comforting that with God in control, and if I'm trusting God, if I fall on my face, well, Jeannie knows all about that, but she did it for a different reason. If we fall on our face as total failures, God picks us up, brushes off the road dust, pats us on the back and says, let's keep going. God doesn't hold our failures against us because, as we read, the human strength is actually weakness. God's power gives us strength. And so we don't have to carry this tremendous burden that some preachers, theologians, and doctrines lay on us, that we must tithe and we must witness and we must read the Bible and we must pray and we must go to church and we must keep the Sabbath. We must and we must and we must. And if you do that, you'll get musty. Because it's what God has done for us that makes all the difference. How freeing that is. We are told if Jesus makes us free, we are free indeed. We are free not in this life only, but forever. The cross reminds us of that, that God is at work. There's nothing we could do in the end to pay for our sins. Though, obviously, before Jesus, people whose heart was pure before God, God dealt with them very kindly, just as now. It's just that we have a certain knowledge about Jesus having come, and we have the symbol of the cross to remind us of God's work. Grace is a word that the church has always used, and it's a difficult word because in today's society it doesn't mean much. Grace is something you say before a meal in our society. And grace is something you are given if your loan payment is due and you don't have it, and they'll give you a month's grace. And so it loses its spiritual importance. Grace, I define as God acting like God because God wants to act like God. So that God's love for us is because God wants to, not because we've earned it. God's answering our prayer is because we are in the will of God. And God is pleased to answer our prayers. Grace is those moments when you have absolutely nothing left, but God's still there. So may I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. We no longer live by social expectations or cultural norms. We live by something far more radical. It's the love of Jesus, the presence of the Holy Spirit, and the worship of the God who created this world. That's worth talking about. That's worth remembering. That's worth accepting as the way in which we live. Thanks be to God. Amen.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, My richest gain I count but loss, and pour content on all my pride.
How can we find the words to praise you, O God, for the love that you have for us? To thank you for what Jesus has done for us. And to stand in wonder and awe at what you continue to do through us and with us each moment of every day, whether we're awake or asleep, conscious or distracted. We pray, O God, for those who have not found the fullness of your grace. We pray that they might be renewed in spirit. We pray for revival in your church, the body of Christ here on earth. And, O God, may we live by the cross, seeing it and knowing that Jesus died for us, not for self, not thinking about himself, but even on the cross, thinking about others, so that he would give us a model for which we could grow, that we might mature and be more and more living in the image of Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit who guides us and shapes us for eternity. We thank you, God, that we are not alone in this struggle. We have each other. And so we share together the words that Jesus gave us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Go out with the cross before you and the world behind you, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. The peace of Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.